If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
Isn't it crazy that it was we were the least excited about it? If I was being completely honest, I lagged the most on looking them up. I was the least excited to talk to them. I almost feel like this always happens to us. It's like, that's why I'm like, so we have an interview tomorrow that when we fly to LA, we're going to go interview someone who I don't like.
No.
And he rubbed me the wrong way because over a year and a half ago, we reached out to him.
Bro, I talked shit to him once on Instagram.
Oh,
remember, we went back and forth.
Yes.
Yeah, so. I don't know if he remembers that, bro.
So, but I've
watched Univision be the big thing.
I told myself, we're going and I'm not going to get upset. We're going to, because it always ends up this way. The ones that I'm frustrated about or I care the least about.
That's true.
And Thrive, for sure. What a fucking badass company, dude. Uh-huh. 1 to 500 employees in 4 years. Huh. The ability for them to...
Bro, their model is the future.
Oh, it's like game over.
That's the future.
If you can offer me...
They'll get bought by Amazon.
Yeah, that or it'll become the direct competitor. I believe my thoughts, after now understanding and seeing Thrive and their mark, or seeing their business, I believe that has to do with Amazon's purchase of Whole Foods. And that's part of their strategy is to become... Think about it. If you're Whole Foods, you probably have some of the best organic connections in the country. So that is probably the hardest part for Thrive, like he said on there, is to get your good streamlines of good organic foods. So if you're Amazon, you go buy the biggest distributor of organic foods, they're going to fuck the stores off.
Yeah, but they have a membership system that's different.
That's all coming, bro. That's all coming. It's fine. It'll be what it's fine.
All right, listen, in this episode of Mind Pump... We get to interview two good friends of ours.
Yep.
We have Martin Silva, who's a competitive physique competitor. He's actually ranked pretty high in which organization?
WBFF.
WBFF. Yeah. Good-looking guy, shredded. And his friend Andrew Bond, who's a personal trainer that I know personally, I've actually worked with. And in this episode, we actually talk a lot about building your fitness business, either as a personal trainer or doing it online. There's a lot of really good information in this episode about, you know, how do you build a business in fitness? Because you have some people who are very successful as personal trainers or gym managers.
Right, they're knowledgeable. They understand the body. You and I have dealt with this for many, many years. A lot of times I would get a guy or a girl, just brilliant mind, great with people, but then just cannot make any money because they can't sell themselves.
That's right. And there's a lot of moving parts there. In fact, this is an area that, in particular, me and Adam trained lots of people for large fitness organizations specifically on this. In fact, I trained probably more trainers than I did clients, to be quite honest. And we talk a lot about what to do in this episode. And we recorded this episode a while ago. We hadn't aired it until now because we wanted to put together a date for a free, you know, mastermind here at Mind Pump Media for trainers.
It's how to build a six-figure plus business in the fitness industry is the idea. And the reason why it's free is because we know this first time, and we'll just be completely transparent with what we're doing right now. And that is, we want to invite, you know, we're going to bring down, I don't know however many we can fit. I know Doug will decide that as far as how many people actually be able to fit in here that we can organize it and run it right. And then it's going to be a lot of conversation because we want to find out what are the things that we can do to help those that are wanting to either get into the fitness industry or already currently in there and want to make more money doing that. So this first one is going to be a lot about finding out where can we help you as much as possible.
And we'll hang out with you guys for hours and talk about your business and what you can do online, what you can do when you present your product to people, whether it's personal training or your gym. I mean, if you're a gym manager, if you're a personal trainer, if you work in fitness online, like anybody, it's free and it's open to anybody. We're just limited with space. It's October 21st. It's here in San Jose at Mind Pump Media Studio Headquarters. It's going to be in the morning, probably around 10 a.m., I think.
It'll be at 10 a.m. We're going to go all day long, though. It's going to be an all-day event. We'll be there all day, and it'll start at 10 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, right now we haven't closed off on the time that we're going to stop it at because I have a feeling it's going
to
go.
I can't wait, man. I can't wait to, like, sit down with people and, like, dive into their business and help them out. And, again, it's completely free. So here's how you can sign up for it. Again, remember, space is limited, so get on there quick because it probably will fill up fast. It's mindpumpmedia.com/P, the letter P, /money. Again, let me repeat that. mindpumpmedia.com/P/money. So without any further ado, here we are talking to Martin Silva. You can find him on Instagram at Martin Silva Fitness and talking to Andrew Bond, who you can find on Instagram at Mr. Bond Fitness. Here we go. We have two guests with us today. We need to announce who our guests are.
That's right.
Martin Silva. Now, you're a professional physique competitor from the UK.
Yes,
I read an article about you. It said you were one of the up-and-coming talent coming out of the USA. It was out of the UK. It was a very exciting article.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
I don't know who wrote it.
I wrote that one.
My mom did.
And then we got
whoever wrote it, hats off to him.
And then you came with your friend Andrew Bond, who's a personal trainer out in on the East Coast.
That's correct.
East Coast in New York.
Yeah.
You guys have social medias you want to plug?
Yeah. My Instagram is at Martin Silva Fitness, and my YouTube channel, which is up and coming, I'm trying to grow that a bit more. It's just Martin Silva Fitness on YouTube. So that's pretty much it, really.
Excellent.
Means who handles.
You did this
on Facebook
backwards
as well, but
you do a lot of like pornography photos and stuff like that.
Yeah, I wanted to keep that one on the download though. So I want to keep the soft porn on the side, right?
Can I tell you what happened? Legit, right? So I started. So when you were following us and we would talk back and forth, so I'd like your photos because I want to show you support. And a lot of your photos are kind of like these, you know, shirts off kind of.
Oh, yeah.
Sexy.
I'll admit to that.
So I started liking your shit. Next thing I know, the search function, you know, when you go on the search on your Instagram, it's showing me all these fucking dudes.
Yeah. This is what he told us anyway.
You ruined.
Is your Mrs. getting worried about you?
It's the excuse.
Yeah. I'm like, it's because of Martin. You ruined it for me.
Oh, that's great, man. That's good to hear. I ruined your life.
Yeah. Not my life. Just the search part.
Just your Instagram,
Andrew, where do they find you on social media?
You can find me on Instagram at Mr. Bond Fitness. As in Bond, B-O-N-D.
That's a great last name.
James.
Works Andrew my favorite Bond
sometimes, so.
Yeah. Now, you guys have been in fitness for a long time. You're both also personal trainers, and you've been listening to Mind Pump. How did you guys find, Andrew, you found us first.
I found you, stumbled across you by chance, really. I was following your boy Joe Donnelly.
Oh, yeah.
Shout out to Joe Donnelly.
You love a bit of Joe, don't
what
you?
What a great guy.
He's
a stable individual. Very stable.
Shout out to Joe D.
Shout out. You know?
Go follow Joe Donnelly Fitness on Instagram if you can.
Or don't.
So I just stumbled across this page, comment section, and some girl commented, "I love the podcast you were on." And luckily enough, I was just starting going into podcasts at that time. And I looked up your, obviously, Mind Pump Media, and I started backtracking through all your podcasts. Thoroughly enjoyed them, and then I just sent you over to Martin.
I'd like to give you my little story on my first episode of Mind Pump quickly. He introduced me. I scroll through the list. First one I listened to was the CrossFit one. Sold straight away. Oh, mate, it was hilarious. So I was hooked straight on, and obviously I learned a lot off the episode as well. So I was tuned in then from the CrossFit one onwards.
Well, that's like in the beginning.
That's right at the beginning, man.
I backtracked through most of them and then just caught up then, though. So
you can't catch up nowadays, guys. You need to slow down a bit, man.
You do need to slow down. You missed one week with them.
We talk a lot. We like doing that. You were saying how it changed the way you train yourself and train people through the show. What was it? What changed about it? Because you were really into the physique world.
That's right.
At that moment as well.
Yeah. So I stepped on stage for the first time about 3.5 years ago. And basically my whole lifting career has been the typical bro splits, you know, splitting the body parts, never really focusing on doing the body as a whole, and, you know, focusing on training frequency and adaptation as you guys integrate into the programs. So it was just switching over and hitting the body parts more regular. It's just to dumb it down, hitting the body parts more regular by doing the 3 total body sessions. The first plan I'd done was the red maps, which I had awesome results off. The trigger sessions work a treat on the days in between and that. But yeah, anyway, I've always done bro splits and done different body parts. And then I switched over to the Red Maps. I'd done the whole night. It's 9 weeks, I think, the Red Maps one. The results were insane. I mean, strength, also physique as well. And just the fullness of my muscles from doing those trigger sessions of vascularity, everything. And then maybe I should have done the green maps in between, but I went over to the black maps and aesthetics, leading up to a show, actually, leading up to the World Championships. And then I actually had a coach of my own, so I switched over to a different plan. But yeah, in hindsight, I probably would have been better off just sticking to the black maps. Yeah. So I'd done that leading up to coming out here as well for the casting I had out here. Done a black maps aesthetics, just done a phase two and phase three at the end. And yeah, I apply that now. I apply that style of training now to my clients. And
how are they doing with it?
Really well. Yeah, really well. Because you train some people, as you know, once or maybe twice a week. So to get, you know, to get most things covered within that time and get, you know, to get the maximum results, really. The frequency element comes in a lot there as well. So I'll do two sessions with someone and I'll cover all the compound exercises mm-hmm. within those two workouts and get two foundational workouts in with them along those lines of red maps and black maps. And I've integrated Prime into that as well, obviously with all my clients. And what's been a really, really good selling point out in Australia, because obviously I moved over there to start from scratch in my PT business, is the Prime assessments. What are they called again?
The compass assessments.
On the initial session, they worked.
So how many years now have you been training clients?
Oh, a long time, over a decade.
Oh, shit,
yeah,
real long time.
Since I was 19, 20, yeah.
Oh, shit, you started early like I did.
Started early, yeah, like you guys, yes. That's why I can relate a lot to a lot of the stuff you talk about. So.
Very cool. Yeah, it blows me away how full circle some of the stuff is coming, because one of the impetus that kind of got me to create the first MAPS program was identifying how the old-time strongmen and bodybuilders trained before the introduction of steroids, or even before the introduction of protein powders, like way back in the day. And you'd read about their feats of strength and you'd see pictures of their physiques, and it was very impressive, especially considering they had none of them dieted, none of them did anything other than they would train a particular way, and they all trained kind of these full body type routines, and they would all write about certain things. Like I'd read about Eugene Sandow and some of these other strongmen and aesthetic looking physiques back in those days, and they would say things like don't train to failure, but they would use other terminology, and they'd talk about training muscles more frequently and how in between their workouts they would practice movements at low intensities. And once I started kind of opening my mind a little bit and applying that to myself and to my clients, it blew me away. And mainly it blew me away because it was so opposite. Mm. It was so opposite from what I was reading in the bodybuilding magazines and the fitness, forums and stuff. And the funny thing now, it's coming full circle. One of our forum members just shared an article from T-Nation, which, by the way, is a great, for the most part, they've got great articles. And there was an article published, I think about maybe 4 months ago, 3 months ago, that they shared. And the title of it is Split Routines Are Dead. Mm-hmm. That's literally what they said, which I would have never expected from a bodybuilding, muscle building, blog or whatever. So it was really, really cool. But so you're both personal trainers, but you guys were also both talking about trying to build that in other realms. Are there, what are you guys looking to do? We talked about online coaching potentially.
Definitely online coaching. I feel that now that I'm trying to look into other businesses like real estate back home with my sister, because I can't see me doing, pushing out 10, 12 sessions a day like I'm doing at the moment. It's so tiring. That's something I don't want to do into the future. As passionate as I am about it, I can't see myself doing that in my 40s, 50s.
People don't realize when you train, seven clients or eight clients in a day, they think you train 7 or 8 hours.
Mm. I think it's easy, man. Working with different personalities for those 7 to 8 hours as well is difficult for your mind as well.
Mentally training, exactly. It's not just physical. I mean, you're physically actually lifting weights and spotting people for 7, 8 hours. But then on top of that, you're also, like you said,
you're on.
You're on. You're talking to, if you're good, right? If you're really good, you're a chameleon and you're able to mirror whatever client you have, which is going to require...
And you're absorbing the energy they're bringing in, which a lot of times is super draining.
Hell yeah. So sure. I think a lot of people don't realize how much that takes to be able to... And then to do it well, right? Because you're trying to give a very personalized, great session, great training regimen from somebody who is fully on. You don't want one client paying the same as your first client who gets energy filled at him when he gets to work. But then when
just
he's
like
done.
You said before, actually, it just came back to me then. You said, you know, which I've something I've taken on board is a good trainer is always a therapist before they actually are a trainer. That makes sense. So it's delving deeper into the psychological issues and elements and components that come into getting, you know, achieving your goals. And that's the part which can be taxing, isn't it? It's the psychological side of it, the energy you're kind of exerting. You know?
In fact, I just got. I don't know if you don't mind me sharing, I work with Andrew virtually, so I do some coaching with him, and he had asked me, you know, how if I had any techniques or any advice for when, you know, you work with a client, how to not take on their stress or not take on some of their issues, because when you're working with people on a one-on-one basis. People will come in with problems. They'll come in with stresses. They'll come in with just their energy could be, you know, low or they could be, you know, irritable or whatever in a bad mood. And it's hard not to take that on, especially if you're an empathetic individual, which most personal trainers who stay as personal trainers, part of the reason why they do it is they like people. They are empathetic individuals. So it becomes a very difficult thing, not to mention, again, like what we were just talking about earlier, you're on the entire time. So if you're working 8 hours, for those of you listening that have a typical, you know, 9-to-5 job, you know most of you are not working for 8 hours. You're not on for 8 hours.
Well, the irony is the better you get, the harder it becomes. The better you become at your job, which is that ability to be a chameleon, to be able to service each one of those people individually and give them what they need, energy, motivation, direction-wise, it becomes even more taxing on you, right?
So it becomes taxing using the concepts that I've learned, though, you know, recently, even through this podcast alone, is just actually getting to take a step back a lot of the time because people are normally too stressed out in life, aren't they? Mm. They're normally doing too much or they're not doing enough. They're not eating right. They're not doing enough mobility. So it's taking them a step, getting people to slow down and focus more on, you know, stretching and then, you know, doing maybe a strength phase with them and doing different things with them and kind of getting them to, like I said, slow down is a hard, that's a task within itself, isn't it, this day and age?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, one thing that I thought a lot about Andrew's question when he asked me that, and I gave him some advice, but then I thought some more about it. And I realized that one of the things that I did that was really effective as a personal trainer that made it easy for me was I started to become a little bit selfish. And what I mean by that is I started to realize that as much as I had to show and teach my clients and the reason that they hired me, I also was able to learn and grow from them. So, you know, I got an opportunity to train, you know, a doctor or a surgeon. Well, during the session, I'm going to ask them questions about things I'm interested in that have to do with medicine, medications or procedures, or maybe someone's an executive at a tech company. I'm going to ask them questions about what they're doing. There is a dual purpose there. People do like to de-stress by talking about certain things and it makes them feel better. On the flip side, I'm learning. I get the opportunity to work with all these different personalities and learn from them. And the result of that was doing, you know, after doing that for 10 years of working with all these professionals, I just became well versed in all these different subjects. And I looked forward to showing up to work rather than sometimes being like, oh man, I'm so tired. What am I going to do? It's like, oh shit, I get to go meet with so-and-so who's a general surgeon. I can't wait to hear about the cases that they've been working on.
Yeah, exactly.
And I would ask them detailed questions. They actually appreciated it. I got something out of it. And then I didn't feel like I was just giving and going home, you know, totally spent. That became the highlight of personal training for me. It was like I was going to school every single day and I would come out of it, you know, smarter and, you know, more informed. And again, the side effect was I became so much of a better personal trainer as a result. But I'd say one of the biggest drawbacks of personal training as a career, if you're going to stay in that, you know, that particular specific part of the field, is you're limited by the amount of hours of the day. You can't see more than, I mean, 8 clients a day, 5 days a week is very, very exhausting.
Oh, for sure.
In fact, when we worked for big corporate fitness facilities, they considered full-time 6. 6 clients a day was full time.
Yeah.
I also think that the business model is changing. It's changing and it will continue to change. And I think fitness is a little bit behind. And that was part of what inspired Mind Pump when we got together. We all kind of saw that, like, man, when you look at like, and we're lucky, we're blessed, we're in the Silicon Valley, so we get to see a lot of tech stuff move pretty fast and we see it early before the rest of the country does, right? So that being said, I think when, and someone, Justin's loves this stuff, when you start looking at like where all these other businesses are moving and fitness is really kind of in the stone age, we kind of knew that. I foresee that one-on-one type of coaching, that's starting to go away more and more and more, because there's always going to be those people out there that will pay whatever amount of money to have one person giving them all their attention. There'll be a market there, but that market's going to shrink, because we went through in about 2000, and if you guys should remember because you've been around so long, is in the early 2000s, we went through that huge boom. Everybody was making money. Everyone was spending money on personal training. It was cool to say I had a personal trainer. And then we hit the bubble burst and the market took a shit. And then all of a sudden training actually became a real, like it was hard to get a client now, where I was part of the era before, during and after. And I remember that transition and what that felt like.
Everybody was doing boot camps at that point, right?
Yeah. And
they were trying to get.
And I did also, right? So I at one point realized like I got used to a certain amount of income as a trainer. And now in order to make that same kind of money, I had to get creative. I had to do other things than just take on all these people that wanted a personal trainer to say they had a personal trainer. Now only the people that could afford it were coming and getting training. And so that forced me to think outside the box, and that been the group training. And I was doing that a long time ago. And you see now like Orange Theories, your Soul Cycles, all these little small little boxes are like the new thing, right? Where they have, it's almost like private coaching because you get a trainer to yourself, but then there's 20 to 30 in a class. So it's intimate, but yet class-like. So you see that model going, right?
Yeah, now you have metrics and all these biomarkers that you can sort of follow. Mm. And I think that's, honestly, that's where the tech boom is really kind of coming in. And they're trying to grab all these different like data points. And so, you know, if you're a trainer now, I think what's the smart approach, and you're talking about being able to scale, right? That's the biggest issue, because like you can only train so many hours of the day. Mm-hmm. You really got to figure out your process. You got to figure out your protocol, and like every single step to that process, like make notes and keep that in your mind, as far as like how can you duplicate yourself. How can you duplicate yourself? Write it all out. What are the steps you take with each individual case? What are the variables? All that kind of stuff. Because later on, that's going to be valuable, because you're going to be able to now take a lot of that information and you're going to be able to put it in some form of an app or some form of a tech a device, and you're going to be able to reach a lot more people.
That's my plan, CJ. That's actually, obviously I've came over here for like a modeling gig.
Mm-hmm.
Providing I land this, it should pay really well. And I'm looking to, I've had a website in place, by the way, you can check it out. It's a
shameless plug.
Yeah. I want to try and build it up. Let's plug all the holes.
He's also selling, selling maps programs on there as well.
So. We appreciate
it. It's www.redtube.com.
Some of your Instagram pictures.
That's a great site.
I mean, YouTube. It's Martin-Silva. Martin-Silva.com. But anyway, yeah, I'm looking to focus more on the online stuff. And like you said, the main thing is to scale it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm actually designing my own programs. Obviously, I had a word with Sal, inspired by you guys. So from what I've learned and stuff, I'm looking to get my own programs in place now as a first step. There's a few other things I've got in mind, ideas as well. But like you said about an app as well, I've been looking into potentially doing that one day as well. But yeah, that's where it's at, really. You've got to kind of move with the times, if you like, now.
Well,
and technology, you've got to capitalize on that.
And you can move into that realm, but there's a lot of trainers who don't want to, and they say, look, I just want to work with clients. I just want to work with people. I want to touch people. I want to be in front of people. I don't necessarily want to spread out, which is fine too, but there are smart ways of doing it.
Yeah, but when you say that, a trainer that says that to me is the same thing I'd say back to that trainer who's like, oh, I just want to be a trainer. I just want to help people. I don't want to sell anything.
Yeah, I don't want
to. You have to learn to look at the, it's a business.
Yes, you do got to do that. But what I was going to say is there's very smart ways of structuring your business that are going to help you be more successful. Like, for example, the way Justin's did his personal training, the way he structured, the way clients paid him, I think is fucking brilliant. I didn't even do when I had my wellness facility. I wish I did, because it was, I don't know if you want to kind of go into how that works. Because usually with personal training, the way it works is people will buy sessions, right? Mm-hmm. They'll buy a package of sessions, 10 sessions, 20 sessions, 30 sessions.
And you try and hustle them through these sessions in order to get a re-sign.
Yeah, exactly. And you had it set up a little differently.
Yeah, so I basically kind of flipped it and made sure that I have a month to month basis of like, okay, you have an availability. You have, you know, 1, 2, 3, you know, sort of sessions available for you per week. And so, you know, what we do is we agree upon this ahead of time. So, you know, within the month, you have X amount of sessions that you can, you know, accomplish. And we're going to go ahead and schedule it out and do all this ahead of time. But you're going to pay me for that up front. And, you know, my time is valuable. Your time is valuable. This actually puts it back, the ball back into their court. So it's not like you as a trainer, you have to like constantly barrage them with text messages and trying to get them to stay motivated and come into the gym. And I mean, obviously you're still going to want to do that because you want the long term, you know, you want them to keep enjoying the process, but you know, you have to think of yourself as a professional and like this, you have to value yourself. Mm. And so, you know, I charged up front and I charged a flat fee. And then it,
so it'd be X amount of dollars that they pay just monthly.
Yep.
And it's sessions available and it's up to them.
So if they don't show up, then that's it. They lose the money.
They lose it.
Right.
They lose it.
Or they can maximize them and use them. So I'm available 3 sessions
exactly.
a week.
Exactly. We can,
you know, it's $3,000 a month or whatever your fee is. Mm-hmm. And so then you have a bunch of clients who are paying you a flat monthly fee as a personal trainer. Business wise, it's good because, you know, when Justin told me how he structured, I was like, fuck, that's the way it needs to go, because one of the biggest problems with being a personal trainer is the instability of monthly income.
That's the other thing.
Yeah, because you could go like, this month I re-sign all these people, then for 2 months I don't, and I don't know how to. This is like, you know exactly what your monthly.
And there's ways to kind of like, if you're currently just doing like 10, 20, 30 session, you know, like the old kind of model where you're trying to sell those as packages, and you're trying to run these people through. So once it ends up, I just started to slowly kind of convert all my clients into this month-to-month basis. And, you know, obviously you kind of give them a little bit of a break, you know, because it's a flat fee. So, you know, but even just scaling back a little bit on price for a flat fee for per month, it was a consistent payment process. Now I have like ways that I can incorporate that money and plan out my marketing strategy, you know, all the other components of business that you need to be, have reliable income to lean on. So that was huge.
Yeah. What I like about that too, is it puts more responsibility to the client to show up and work out. And that model, what's that called something, because they're doing it with healthcare now.
Yeah, it's
some doctors are doing it.
Yeah,
now.
And it's popular for you to group things. Personally, I think that was great 4 years ago when Justin was killing it and doing it. I think now
this is a good point.
I think now you need to have evolved your social media business to a point, because that is the direction it's going. Yeah, you will see this, mark my words, in the next couple of years, you will see where I don't know where you guys are at, what the big chains are. Over here, it's like the 24 Hour Fitness, the LA Fitness. These are the big chains. You will see big chains. Their training staff will be full of 10 trainers. Not only will they all be educated, experienced, fit, good looking, but they'll also have 10,000 Instagram followers, 5,000.
Oh yeah, you gotta have that.
That will become part of
it. All about,
you're already seeing this in other parts of the other industries that are always ahead of fitness. Fitness is always behind on this shit. But you're already seeing this where application process will ask for people's social media following. Mm. Because there's a lot of power in employing somebody who is, if I have the two of you and you're coming to me and you want a job, let's say for Mind Pump, you're going to come work, you want to work for me, I'm going to offer you great, great pay. I like you both a lot. You both pass all the characteristics tests. And I go, well, he's got 10,000 followers. He doesn't like social media. He's off of it. He doesn't care. Whatever that. Well, who the fuck am I going to hire? It's a no-brainer. That's 10,000 people you're automatically introducing to my business by hiring you on. And multiply that by 10, 15, 20 trainers. This will become a necessity, whether you decide to work for a company or you decide to go privately on your own.
Actually, so, more so if you work for yourself.
It's almost mandatory if you're going to be by yourself. So Justin's model, I'm not knocking that, because 4 years ago...
No, that's part of it. That'd be part of it. The social media is another part of it. You can't ignore.
That's something that you can fix right now. Like if you're a trainer right now and you're not doing that, you can convert over that. That could be a transition you make tomorrow. But you better bet your ass that if you're not getting on your social media at least as a business. And I'll tell you what, and this is coming from a guy who didn't turn on his Facebook, didn't turn on all that shit. I hated all that stuff.
I remember when you used to message me back in the day when we first started kind of talking a little bit. You know, Adam would send me messages and be like, dude, you need to fucking get on Instagram. This is back when me and Doug were putting maps together. And I'm like, Instagram? What the fuck is Instagram? Who cares? I don't want to get on Instagram. He's like, no, you have to get on it. You don't even know. And I'm like, nah, it's whatever. I don't even care about it. I mean, I obviously should have listened back then because it'd be a lot bigger now. But I mean, it's becoming a huge part of business. It will become, I totally agree with you, Adam, it will become the biggest part of business.
It's crazy.
Your net worth, like I say all the time, right? Your true net worth is your net circle. And you, before you even decide how you're going to make money, any of those things, you can be working on your net circle. And I think this is where a lot of people make a mistake. We get so caught up in what I'm going to sell and how am I going to make money versus I need to find the people that would even be considering buying anything from me. And that should be my main priority. And if I need to have something of value to get them to tune in and listen to what I have to say. And if I'm still having a hard time doing that, I'm putting all my energy in figuring that out before I'm even thinking about my.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree. And to bring it back to like the old, you know, when I was actually in the business doing it that way, I was constantly running like Google ads. I was optimizing my website. You know, I was doing all the legwork online to then get the traffic and get that all established. Because you know, with that type of a model, you need to constantly be focused on your marketing and driving that business towards you. So at that point, like when they sign up, it's great because it's reliable income. But you know, that's freeing up my time to work more on, you know, marketing.
You know what? This is a great conversation because I know I get messages from fitness people all the time, trainers, who are always asking me how they can build their social media and how they can, you know, turn that part or at least use that part to help build their business.
This isn't just for trainers, in my opinion. I think this is everybody.
Well, like, I mean, just because that's
anybody who wants to be self-employed, right?
Well, that's just because that's our wheelhouse, right? I usually don't get real estate people messaging me about that, but. So here's another part of that because a lot of them are just worried about the size of their social media, like how many followers I can get. And Adam, you had an interesting experience with your Instagram page. When we first started Mind Pump, you had the social media presence. None of us did at all. So that would kind of give us a little start. But it changed and it shifted with Mind Pump, and it actually became more effective later on, even though it,
with less.
Yeah. So explain that maybe because I always get people asking me how they can get it bigger, and it's not necessarily about the size.
Again, when I first turned on,
that's what she said.
When I first turned on my Instagram, I did it with the intention of building a business. I didn't turn it on to connect to people, to have fun with it because it sounded cool to do. I had already made up my mind that I was going to try and build this business through a social media platform, and I saw where Instagram was going. So when I turned it on, immediately I was already kind of watching what others were doing. Okay, what is this guy doing that's like in my field? What's he doing to have all these people following him? And of course, a lot of the times it was somebody who was already famous and then they got in, then they turned on an Instagram, and then of course they already had a large following. So sometimes it was hard to see, you know, find people. And then after I'd been doing it for a while, I could see somebody who had a small page, and I got to watch them grow and saw some things. And then at the beginning, I was mirroring a lot of what I saw. And a lot of what I saw in the early on, especially in men's fitness and stuff like that, is the, you know, like the half naked photos. Those always get the most likes. It gets the most attention. I'm going to keep posting those. So I posted like crazy. And I was getting at the early on when I first started my Instagram, you know, I was getting up over 1,000 likes on photos and seemed to be growing pretty well. Back then, Justin and I had created the Nutrition Survival Guide, and when we released it, I didn't sell very much, and I was like, "Fuck!" You know, getting all these likes and all my.
You thought I'm getting all this social media.
Yeah, stuff. Right. And so really, if I look back now, if you look all the way back on my IG, you can see it's a lot different now than what it was. And today, it's more me. It's who I am. Like now, I get to just put myself out there as Mind Pump Adam, and this is who I am. This is what I talk about. This is what I'm thinking about. This is what I'm reading. Whatever. Versus when I first started, I was trying to grow the business so much. I was always doing all these things to try and get attention, to get followers, and none of it was really converting to dollars. Now, like a normal picture is like 700 likes or so, but then there's 50 to 100 comments because there are people that are actually fans of the show, engaging, asking questions about fitness. They're not following me because I am half naked and I'm attractive.
I missed the bear rug pics.
that's the difficulty, trying to build your Instagram when, you know, I'm getting the most likes with shirtless pictures.
Yeah.
And then when I'm talking about vegetables and things like that, and I'm getting minimal likes, and I'm like, how do I build this? You
know, so. Yeah, exactly. A plate of veg or someone with his top
off. Someone with his shirt off or the underwear no, showing. No,
that's it.
Well, I went all the way to the length. So I saw this, and I saw that the cleaner the page looks, all these things. So I went and actually, I paid a photographer, took when I got in shape, I came out of my pocket, paid for all of those stuff so I could have photos that I could drip over the course of time. Out. Yeah, leak them out and then write posts to them. So I tried to do all that stuff. I did that. I was successful doing that, but I was attracting the wrong people. These aren't people that were going to that wanted to hear me talk about health and fitness and a better way to
just
take
care. Exactly. Look at your pictures.
Exactly. Just stay true to yourself.
Where I was at as well. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, if I now if true. I was selling men's underwear and stuff like that, that probably would have been a good strategy, yeah. Right? But it wasn't
specific of a new. Yeah, and that's the same position I was in as well. I built all the following up, you know, doing the competitions and stuff. It was a given that most of the photos were like half naked photos. You know what it's like when you're shredded. It's mm-hmm. like you get the pictures up there, you get the likes, you're building your follow. My following was flying up. And then I started going more, right, okay, now it wasn't like yourself where I went in there initially with a game plan. It was just like I was doing competitions. I was actually sponsored by a supplement company back in the day as well as one of those.
Getting a free tub of protein.
Yeah, a free tub of protein a month, you know, making it all worth my while, all that hard work.
A t-shirt.
All those sweeteners and stuff. No, but yeah, that's it. And it kind of slowed down. Well, I took the educational route, as you say over here, took the educational route, it slowed down. My following definitely slowed down and the likes weren't coming in as thick and fast. But now I'm noticing, I'm seeing the trend of people I'm attracting now, people who actually want to be educated more, want to learn more about health and fitness, which is good. So I'm slowly veering away from the wrong kind of followers.
So my
page is a good example of that. And by no means am I an expert at social media. This is something that's still relatively new to me. I'm probably... when it comes to the aesthetics of the page and all that stuff and understanding it, I'm probably the worst. But one thing I do, I think, very well is deliver information. And so I don't have a massive page, but what I do have is followers who follow me, who value my content, which translates into it translates into business if I want it to. In other words, I have a good conversion rate. And I noticed, you know, I have friends and stuff who've got much larger pages who aren't able to convert their pages because people don't follow them for their value in terms of their information and stuff. It's just to look at them. And so that's something to think about, because if you're in fitness, it's very tempting to do that because fitness is so cosmetic driven. It's very tempting to be just all about your looks, and you will get a lot of followers, especially if you're a female. If you're a female and you're very good looking and you're very fit and you're posting half naked pictures, you'll get 10,000 followers. I mean, you're going to get 10,000. You have those. If you
what
have
kind
those
of, what kind of followers do you think they'll be then?
Right.
Most of the
well, I'll give you.
And what are they going to buy from you if you're trying to build?
We
a
actually
business?
They
ain't going to buy shit, right?
We actually made sure that we tested this theory too. Is we paid we paid $1,500 or $1,800.
Oh yeah.
To a girl who had
a million.
Four million followers, and had her do multiple posts about Mind Pump, and we didn't get shit from it. I mean, we didn't get hardly anything. So
you think 4 million people...
You might have had a few new followers, but you're not going to get any direct conversions necessarily because of the type of people.
That's the thing. Like, you think 4 million followers, you're thinking, wow, we're going to do a couple posts. Like, this is going to be massive. And you know what her followers did is they looked at it and like, this is not a naked picture. This is not a butt. I don't give a shit. And they don't want to even... They don't even care what she has...
Over it. It's funny.
And they don't even care what she has to say. Now, on the flip side, if we had... I don't know, somebody who has a lot of content on their page, somebody whose followers follow them because they really like a coach or a trainer, or even someone like a Lane Norton post, hey, look at this new program that I'm following. It's really good. We're going to see a huge bump because the followers are following him because they respect their information and their content. So I heard this from, I can't remember where I heard this, and I'm not sure if this is accurate, and I'm sure someone will correct me if I'm wrong, but I read somewhere that really all you need for an online business to be very successful, and that, by the way, not everybody's going to be, you know, multimillionaire, you know, successful with online business. But most people can do very well with an online business, can really support themselves well, and you need somewhere like maybe like 5,000 to 10,000 like dedicated, you know, customers or followers. That's it. I mean, there was a podcast when me and Doug were talking about. You know, we were doing online marketing with Mass before Mind Pump even started. We had thrown around the idea of a podcast, and one of the ones we looked to was, I think, Entrepreneur on Fire, if I'm not mistaken, and a popular podcast. And the guy would openly talk about the amount of revenue he would generate.
Oh my God.
He was generating something like a quarter million dollars a month and revenue, but it wasn't very many customers. It wasn't like he was getting shit tons of customers. He had a really good product. It was a high-priced product, but he delivered lots of value. So he only needed like a couple thousand customers to be able to generate this tremendous amount of revenue because of the value he brought. And that's something that people should consider if they're trying to build a business. Because I think a lot of times, at least this was for me, I was very confused. I'd look at social media and think, oh, this will never work for me. I can't get, how am I going to get half a million followers or a million followers? That's never going to happen. You don't have to have that. You can actually, if you're a personal trainer and let's say you just want to build an online coaching business and you're delivering good content and you want to make a decent living, you know, 10,000 like good followers who are following you for your content is plenty to be able to do that off of. You don't need a ton. And almost anybody can develop a page with a couple years worth of work of dedication to be able to build that. So, but I do think it's important that maybe we tell people or give people tips on how to do that. Because I swear to God, Adam, I must get at least a message a day on how to do that. And that, I think, is such a big part.
Well, I think
being consistent, though, like you said, just being consistent with what the information you are given and not veering away from what you're doing.
Yeah, I think that we're in an era now of like transparency is king. With all the abilities to Photoshop and go rent a Lamborghini and take pictures in front of it, to do all these crazy things and to pretend like you're something that you're not, I think somebody who's willing to humble themselves, squash their ego a bit, and just be real, like the struggle's real, this is what it's like doing what I'm doing, and sharing that journey, I think, for people, it's really rare. It's rare to find that. Everybody is putting their best foot forward. And I think being different than everybody else, you got to be different, or you got to be able to provide something that somebody else can't provide like you, right? So
authentic, isn't it?
Exactly. And I think when you the more authentic that you can be, I think that's the first key. But then there's like some real, like, I think important tips too. And Sal said something that I continue to razz him about. So learning to speak to your platforms. In a perfect world, Sal's content would be on Facebook, on our Facebook page, and his Instagram would look more like our Mind Pump Media IG page. So you got to speak to your platform. So Instagram is got it where it's at. The reason why half naked pictures get so many likes is people are scrolling through a feed. It's fast. Yeah. It's instant. I'm going through. I see a hot picture. I like it. I move next picture.
I don't think they read it sometimes.
They don't.
You can do an experiment with that. You've done that before.
Yes,
right?
I've actually tested that. Where I'll put something
in there.
Yeah, inside the content that's fucking obvious to what I'm saying, and people still ask the question. Yeah. I'm like, you didn't read the four lines I wrote. Like, so that's Instagram. So knowing that. And if you're trying to grow it, when you look out, when I open, I do this all the time, right? I open up and I look at my homepage and I look at it from a bird's eye view. Is it aesthetically pleasing? Does it make me want to go to the see what that picture is and look at it? And that means everything from the photos are clean and professional to interesting enough to where I'd want to tap on it. So, you know, those are simple things that you can already start thinking about right now for those that are trying to grow a social media business. And then Facebook, you do actually get people that will read blogs. It's more of a blog setting. It still appeals to the older generation that like ourselves that will read content that long. So good long content belongs to some of that. Twitter, fast, smart, witty, good to the point, punctual information. So learning to speak to your platform is another thing that's important too, and getting good at it and actually treating it like that. If you're trying to build it and decide that, right, is this your page to show me your family and your kids and your hot girlfriend, or is this your business page? You know, distinguish that. You know, am I, you know, trying to build a business around your half family, half, you know, party fun life, half business? Like, you know, if you're really treating it like a business, it should kind of reflect whatever your business idea is too. So I think that's important.
And I think some really general advice that we've really tried to capitalize on, or at least has become a part of our brand, is deliver and give as much free stuff as you possibly can, as much information, as much access as you possibly can, because whether you like it or not, and this was really hammered home to us by one of the guests that we had on our show, Tom Bilyeu, and that's basically anything that can be free will be free at some point. And we're seeing that with big media like TV, you know, music. Like the more free it can be, the more free it's going to be. And if someone can give where you're giving away for free, they will, and you're done. Mm. And so you got to learn how to work with that.
And you got to do that. You got to be consistent with that as well. It's not just something you can give a few free, you know, articles out, for example, or whatever you're going to give out, you know, information. It needs to be consistent. You have to do it for sometimes years on end consistently before you get any comebacks or any positive comebacks.
Well, we were talking about that with the YouTube. Like, you know, if we're being completely transparent, I mean, I think we make a whole like $3 a day on YouTube.
Boom.
But yeah, exactly. Right. Doesn't even pay for the electricity.
$3 a day can feed this.
So
looking at the bigger picture.
And every day we're adding 50 new to 60 new subscribers, but it's slow. Mm. It takes time. It takes a lot of work.
Rome wasn't built in the day, was it?
Right. And if we're thinking about all the ways that I'm going to make money off of it right now, like we're not thinking correctly. We're always trying to enhance the channel. So, you know, like I told you.
Yeah, we're not even thinking about money from YouTube. Yeah. It's all about like just how can we make it better? How can we make give more and just keep doing that? Like when we turned on Mind Pump, we didn't monetize. We didn't ask for a single dollar for a full year.
No.
When we had the podcast, because we knew like we just want to give people so much that by the time we do offer something, they see the value in it and they say, okay, I want to support, you know, support this podcast or whatever. I want to get this product because I've been listening to these guys talk for.
Well, and when you analyze all the big YouTube stars, right? The ones that have the gold button, right? 1 million+ subscribers and are making a ton of money through YouTube. Most of them, that's what they've just for 9-10 years, they've been given lots of great free information.
And they were first to market.
Yeah. First to market. Great information early on, tons of it consistently over 9-10 years. I mean,
it's a good idea to really look at, you know, what's trending as far as like a new platform. So like our guy was telling us a little bit about Medium as being a good place to blog now because it's getting a lot of traction.
It's like a blog social media.
Yeah, and there's just stuff like that. Like you want to keep your eyes peeled if like you're just starting out. It's probably might not be the best idea to start with something that's like totally overly saturated, right? So, I mean, or maybe do that as sort of like in conjunction with, but really keep your eyes peeled for the thing that like everybody's gravitating towards because it does. It makes a difference when timing all, you know, lines up, you know, you're first to market, you have a good message. People will find you a lot easier that way. So just something to consider, you know.
I'll tell you what really trips me out, by the way, that seems to be my phrase now. People have told me that. They've quoted me and it trips me out. Apparently I say that a lot.
You stole my wheelhouse when we first started. I was like, fucking A, this guy.
This is my wheelhouse.
Now he's taking my sayings too?
Oh man. We're still trying to find mine.
What are you talking about? I was the one that first said that. Yeah. Anyway, you know what really trips me out now is that the celebrities of tomorrow are all social media.
Oh yeah,
it's no longer like,
dude. You're starting to see commercials of that, like dude, it's internet fucking crazy star so and so, and you're just like, what?
Yeah, my kids. They don't know TV stars or movie stars too much, but they definitely know social media stars. You go to fitness. You guys go to fitness conventions, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Like the Olympia and all that. Who has the long lines now?
Physique guys or Instagram guys?
There's
Shreds.
Yes.
When you see someone like
Swole,
right.
Swole. Shout out to him and Joe Downey together.
Together.
Queuing up for a picture for the grind.
Those guys.
Team Dynamite.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Divide
I mean,
and conquer.
That was a. I remember that.
That's a trip, dude. That it was is, like that,
four,
it happened overnight.
4 or 5 years ago, I was at Olympia and I went out there by myself. It was like we were barely starting like any social media stuff. We hadn't even really kicked off Mind Pump, and I was already kind of feeling out the industry and seeing where who's moving, who's doing what. And I was at Olympia, and I remember like. That was actually the first time I had seen. I remember. I don't know if you guys remember. Do you remember me taking a picture of the banner of Joey Swole?
Yeah,
you guys
I
and being like, bro, you guys are gonna trip out.
And that's like Rich Piana.
Piana was gonna say, God,
right? I'm like, dude, there's literally Ronnie Coleman and Jay Cutler over here, and nobody's talking to them. They're like, there's two people in line to talk to them, and fucking Joey Swole has a fucking line out the door. I was like, this is crazy. And this guy is, all he's done is done something on Instagram. You know, like,
nuts, isn't it? Who's the 5%, who's the 5% guy? The 5%.
That's Rich Piana.
Yeah, Rich Piana, that's right. Yeah. At the Body Power in England.
He's big in those expos, yeah.
The queues, man, for like days and days.
Are you
non-stop queues? Like, I'm talking, they never ended. Lines of people.
How big is the fitness world out there in the UK and Australia? Is it big?
Huge, yeah. I think it's a global thing now, but in westernized countries now, I think it's. it's just expanding fast. But Australia, in comparison to Britain, they're a lot more serious about their training out there, especially where I live in the eastern suburbs.
In Australia,
yeah, for sure. They're kind of a bit more ahead of the game, a little bit more ahead
nutrition
of the game in terms
well,
of what they know with nutrition and just generally they're a bit more educated when it comes to health and fitness out there. But at the same time, because the fitness industry is saturated with information which isn't really correct, a lot of them are brainwashed with the wrong concepts. But in comparison to the UK, they're a step ahead. It's the weather and stuff as well. All
outdoors,
these things play a part.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I mean, there's beaches everywhere. Yeah. Where there's a beach, you have your top off. And it's vanity. It comes down to vanity a lot of it, doesn't
it?
So much about health.
You were saying earlier off air that there's even guys are having challenges with their insecurities.
The northern, over the bridge in northern Sydney, it's actually a bit of an epidemic now where you read about in the paper where there's guys like... committing suicide and stuff. Younger guys.
You're shitting
from
me.
From the age of 15 to about 18, I think.
Why? Because
why?
I think it does come down to like body image and stuff like that. Apparently.
Wow. Yeah, and these are guys.
These are disorders. Yeah, in guys, which is actually more popular than women having those issues in the northern side of Sydney.
You know what's interesting about that? So I actually speculated this with my girlfriend not that long ago, where I was talking about how. Historically, it's been women who have had to deal with the brunt of this advertising in terms of, you know, you need to look a certain way. And it really because it started with fashion when it came with clothes and whatever, and women need to look a certain way and bathing suits and all that stuff and diet pills. And you're seeing a lot more of it now go towards men, not more than women, but a lot more than it was historically.
Social media has got to be the massive part in it.
And so now you're seeing more and more of these problems show up with men, which you didn't really deal with so much, even when I was a kid.
Definitely not.
So that's crazy that you're seeing
it's
these
like
guys.
It's like you said, with people scrolling through, though, you know, say people are scrolling through and liking pictures on Instagram. A lot of people are just scrolling through and comparing themselves to other people, which then just multiplies these issues, doesn't it? You know what I mean? It's not going to make it any better.
So how do you guys deal with it? Because you're both pretty fit, good looking guys or whatever. How do you guys deal with that? Did you guys get into fitness because you felt like that about yourself, or was it
with me? Go first.
I got into fitness from playing sport, really. So
same,
it wasn't about body image at that time, but it's definitely escalated over the years. It's gradually got worse for myself as well with self-esteem. You know, I think finding you guys.
I thought you were going to say
Sal's
coaching then.
Sal's coaching is send it downhill.
Good selling point, mate.
Yeah, but even in comparison, you know, I'm comparing myself to Martin sometimes, and I'm like, you know, he's a WBFF pro, and that's difficult for me as well, you know, lining up next to him on the beach because he's on another level to me. I see that.
Well, I'm not really.
I've just got to be acceptable.
Just genetics.
Yeah, he's great genetics, you know, and I've just got to accept that and work towards my own body goals and body images much better. But I found that difficult as well.
I'm blushing now, mate. Stop it.
Sorry.
Now you guys have been traveling through the U.S. doing some work and doing some vacation and stuff like that. Fit, good-looking guys. You got an accent. That's got to be a magnet.
Slam.
I can't even imagine.
You got to be slam.
I have a ring on my finger, so I just got to do it. All
right. Yeah, exactly.
The rings of power. Yeah.
So he's just been leaving me to the business.
I mean, sat in my room on my own.
You know, that's a really good point, though, because I remember being a personal trainer, and one of the things that I struggled with was I always got really frustrated that I thought, man, I have the knowledge. I work out hard. Why the fuck can I not look like the magazine cover? Like, why can't I get to that point? And, you know, really, when I talk to clients and I help them when they give me their goals, right? Like, I think part of that, your job is really helping them understand what that really looks like, because there's so much bullshit out there with magazines and now social media that most of us, including ourselves, can get a very distorted view of what healthy, fit, and a realistic body type to maintain while you have other goals in your life.
Yeah.
Because let me tell you, being stage ready and building a fucking massive business at the same time is fucking difficult.
Difficult to say the least, mate. Jesus.
Right. I tell them they don't know how difficult it is to get to that stage as well. They think it's easy to get down to those body fat levels. I'd love to do what you do and I want to do your training and diet plan. You don't.
It takes a lot of time.
You have different goals in mind.
Like,
You feel tired all the time, lack of energy, your libido is low.
Right.
Why do you want to be like that?
Right.
Same as me though with the training. I've always been active as well, so I've always played sports like rugby and whatever else when I was younger. So getting into training then, I think it was something similar to what Sal said. It's like obviously when you're younger, 15, 16, you want the women at that point. You start you know, kind of chasing women or whatever. And then obviously playing rugby as well. I wanted to be a bit bigger for that. And then I just loved it and just kind of kept it going, kept the momentum. Mm. And I've never stopped really for like the 15 years or whatever when it comes to lifting weights. But yeah, that's it. When it, people who come into it now as, you know, from scratch, and you've got social media to compete with, and they're comparing themselves with other people, you know, it's just trying to lay it out to them that it doesn't happen overnight, and you've got to eat right and all the other elements that come into it. It's not just what you do in the gym. It's the lifestyle and stuff.
Martin, when would you say you were in the worst shape of your life?
Worst shape, right now,
I think, after this week of vacation.
Worst shape of my life was actually, I had a little rebound after shows before. I won't go into that.
We had a lot of days where we were binge eating badly.
I was going to say, exactly. Going to the relationship with food, I mean, with the competitions and stuff, after the first few shows, I rebounded afterwards, which is quite a common thing. But one time, it was like around about Christmas time. So I had a show in like November, and then I had about it was at the end of November, and I had about 3 weeks, actually up until past Christmas, it was pretty much a month of just destructing, really. I was training maybe two or three times a week, half-hearted sessions, and I was just eating rubbish food for about a month solid, and that was probably the worst shape I've got in. But that, you know, I pulled it back fast enough. It wasn't like I left it for, you know, longer than a month or anything, or done any permanent damage, touch wood, to my metabolism.
So do you realize, there's a growing epidemic right now with that, with these people, because of Instagram, because of social media, I shouldn't say because of it, but if one of the factors that plays into this, I think, it's very popular now, men's physique and women's bikini. These categories are exploding and everybody's wanting to get diet down for a show. Mm-hmm. And it's becoming a very popular goal that people have. Like, hey, you know what? I believe I can do that. One day I want to do it. And they set this goal to do that with just that. It's not something they want as to be a part of their life forever. It's just, I want to prove to myself I can get that kind of shape. And so they're hiring these coaches that are helping them get stage ready, which are starving their bodies and training them like shit. And then they go into they get down to the leanest they've ever been because they've been starved for 8-10 weeks for a show, and they come out of it and they rebound like a motherfucker. Yeah. And they go on this huge climb.
Put on like 28 pounds a week or something.
It happens
all the time. And it's such a common thing. I mean, most people do it. But like you said, people don't go into these shows into these competitions for the right reasons. A lot of people do it for insecurities, you know. Maybe deep down, one of the reasons I did it might have been related to that. I can't say, you know, directly it was, but a lot of people do it for the wrong reasons without realizing it. They're kind of they're making things worse because they want to do it to make themselves feel better about themselves. Sometimes it doesn't always happen like that, does it, Ed? You know how it is when you do a show. You know, sometimes you don't get the placing you want. You go in, you know, really confident. You don't get where you want to get. You put your heart and soul into it. You rebound afterwards. Then you've got all this emotional kind of destruction, or you call it the symptom eruption or whatever it is. You've got that to deal with then afterwards. And it can be a bad outcome. So.
Yeah, one of the most powerful phrases that I ever used as a personal trainer with clients is, many times people would hire me and I'd ask them why. I'd always ask why. So that, you know, what are your goals? I want to lose 30 pounds. I want to whatever, you know, build muscle. And I'd ask why. And it usually would come down to, well, if I lose, you know, 30 pounds, then I'll be happy. Usually it would break down to that. And I would always tell them, it was a very powerful, effective phrase that I used for a few years, where I tell them, well, you can't lose weight to get happy. You have to get happy to lose weight. So it's something it's the goal that you think you're going to get to, and that's going to change you and make you feel so amazing. It never happens. You've got to find that before you actually start to go for that goal, if you're looking for long-term real success, because the people who seek happiness out of just changing their body in these dramatic ways end up finding at the end of that, number one, their perception of the self is so skewed that they never reach what they think that they need to look. And they find that there's no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And at that point, it's very difficult.
What ends up happening, because they become so fixated on that, they go about it the wrong way. And then their motivation's so wrong. They're so driven by the number coming off on the scale that they go about it all the wrong ways, which ends up just making it worse for them. So even if they go all the way through and actually achieve that goal, they look back at the journey and they're like, fuck that. Yeah. Yeah. I'd rather be 20 pounds heavier, eating the way I was eating, not having to do punishing myself like that every single day in the gym. Like, I was happier.
And then you get this message. I just saw this the other day on, I think it was Facebook. it was this young lady who competed in bikini, so she'd get herself real tiny and just emaciated. And then there was a picture of her next to it now, today, and she's much heavier, probably a little heavier than she should be. I'd say probably about 15 pounds overweight over where she should be in terms of her health. And then the title of it is, you know, I'm so happy now. You know, I never want to do what I did before, and this is the way I'm always going to be, type of deal. And now she's attached herself to that. It went so bad in one direction that then people start to think to themselves, like, well, the only way now I'm going to be happy is if I don't even think about my health. If I don't think, and that's what she said, basically. She eats whatever she wants. She isn't active because that's how she's
flexible
happy.
Flexible dieting, yeah?
And, yeah, exactly. And the problem with that is she's remembering how miserable it was before and thinking, right, this is better than that. But there is a better place. And the better place is when you find that health, when you find the true motivations, when you really take care of yourself, the side effect of that for a lot of people is, they look fantastic. But if you try to do it for the look and that's your sole motivation, you're not going to find it.
You can have abs and be miserable.
For sure, yeah. Nice. I've been there. But you, when I look back at my relationship with food, though, real quick, with the as you were saying then about people attaching, I just want to go into quickly what I've experienced over the last few years. The first few kind of competitions I've done, I probably didn't have the knowledge Adam had going into it. You know, I didn't really have that much of a good knowledge on nutrition. And I basically built up this, it's a bit of an eating disorder, essentially, where I would do a show, rebound for a bit, and then I'd probably just write the whole week off afterwards then, where I wouldn't eat rubbish nonstop day in, day out for a week, but it would be pretty much a whole week of just dropping my guard. And then what I would do then, when I would be back on it as such, I would be looking back, I would just be like depriving myself of loads of different nutrients because I'd be eating the same foods pretty much day in, day out, Monday to Friday, right, for example. I would eat, you know, my salmon, my
chicken
veg, my
sweet potato,
chicken breast and broccoli, you know it. And that's pretty much it.
Brown rice.
Maybe one or two other things. And then on the get to the weekend, I'd be like, oh, okay, you know, I've eaten really healthy all week, which in reality I'd eaten the same foods all week. I'd eaten some good foods, but missing out on a lot of nutrients. And then I would kind of binge eat then. I would have one bad thing. Oh, okay, I've earned this. And then it would turn into a whole weekend. And that went on for about a solid year before I started listening.
I joined you in most of those weekends.
You joined me, yeah. You helped me out. You helped me out, man. We should have recorded. There's one which we were saying we should have.
One weekend, maybe 20, 30,000 calories. Probably.
Within about 24 hours, mate.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Wait, you did what?
Oh, mate, we should have recorded that.
I was actually going into a show myself at the time.
And you've done two or three, haven't you, yourself?
I've done two myself. And it was the end of the British finals. And I think when you eat it, I was expecting him to win. And
He didn't place.
So then when he got off stage, I was like, fuck this. You didn't place. I'm not going to do the show. Threw in the towel, started spreading peanut butter on chocolate rice cakes, and it escalated from there then. So we'll take it through what we had.
You know, it's funny.
How long have you got? We'll tell you what we had.
It's funny you say that. You guys should have recorded it, because I find it very fascinating right now to see. Those are some of the most viral shared videos right now. Is
promoted
these food challenges. There is a ton of these 10,000 calorie, 20,000 calorie. In fact, some of these guys and girls have some of the largest followings right now, and it's a very hot trend on YouTube. And I find it very fascinating how everybody, big part of the population is drawn to seeing this. Even myself could not help but watch it to see, what does this motherfucker eat to get to 20,000 calories? I'm interested.
Yeah, for sure.
And so it's fascinating, and it makes me wonder what that's going to do, you know, and
isn't there a channel dedicated to that now? You can watch people eat food, apparently, on YouTube.
Oh, yeah?
Apparently that's the new channel.
People worldwide now are so emotionally attached to food that, like, that kind of thing is just like goldust, isn't it, to watch someone. You know how big YouTube is now anyway. People don't really watch a great deal of TV unless it's Netflix.
Right.
So it's like, okay, yeah, food. Let's tune into that. Like,
there's that one page. Who's that one guy? Remember I got into it with him because it got so angry when I first saw him. He has this page where this is what he does. He promotes intermittent fasting. So he's like, this is how I stay lean. Meal, right? I intermittent fast and then
eat
whatever.
Shitty foods, though.
And then he makes like these pizzas with like cereal and you know, donuts on it and top ramen, like the the grossest fucking thing I've ever seen in my life. Yeah. And he'll smash this whole thing, and it'll be like 5,000-6,000 calories. And he's like, "But I got abs." And
the, the problem is he's lean, right? So people are going to see that and get away with it. Right?
What's going on inside his body, though, boys? And then what's happening with the gut flora?
Yeah, right.
Oh, he must have the most the most terrible shits.
No, it's crazy. I think it's crazy to see where all this stuff is going. But I, you know, bringing it all the way back to building your business, I think. If you're really trying to scale a business beyond, you know, being, because you guys are full. I mean, you guys have already experienced that, what it feels like to run 8 to 10 clients every single day. Mm-hmm. And you get tapped out. And if you still are looking for more, because some people, I know I have a buddy who's been doing that for years and years and years, and he's very comfortable. He makes good money. He loves it. He loves his loves training clients. No desire to scale out of that. Mm. But those that are looking to scale beyond that and they want more, 100%, you've got to be thinking how you can do that through different social media platforms, because it will be the future. It's here already, and it's soon it'll be a necessity, right? So the sooner you start figuring that out, if you're an entrepreneur at all in any industry, it's a must. Mm. And you know, you're starting to see this more and more companies, and it's a great time to be trying to figure it out, because nobody has it really truly mastered. I feel like I think there's some companies that are doing a lot of things well, but I think there is lots of opportunity to evolve it. And like Sal said, you know, everything becoming free one day, I foresee that this model goes that direction when everything's all put into place. Because then you could potentially do that. Once you build the large enough network, you can provide a lot of really cool shit for free. Mm. So having that mentality of what can I provide to others of value, and trying to progress that as fast as you possibly can.
I'll tell you, when the spirit of transparency, that the direction that Mind Pump is going to be going in the future, I don't know if it's necessarily the close future, but is going to be placing our focus on training trainers and teaching fitness professionals how they can build sustainable six-figure businesses in fitness. And that's going to be a part of it. It has to be a part of it. That's such a big part of business. But there's other pieces too. What are some things you guys would want to learn from or do you think that should be covered in something like that, just to pick your brains a little bit, because you're both still trainers.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so that's the thing. I'll be straight up. So for me, where I kind of need to step my game up is the business side of it. Mm-hmm. So I've got the work ethic, you know. I've built up a good following, but only over, say, the last year or so have I really been focusing on, you know, trying to build a bit of a, you know, like an online empire. Mm-hmm. I had my website. I had a really good website put in place probably about 2 years ago. I started doing the online coaching, as I mentioned earlier. But as you say, unless you've got unless you scale it properly, where you've put the planning into it in terms of the dealing with the, because you're doing personal training on top of that, don't forget. So it's finding the, it's managing your time essentially. Mm. But
so
yeah,
time management would be
Management would be a good one. Also with the business side of it, I think just the social media side of it really, because obviously you guys are experiencing and learning a lot now along the roads when it comes to that side of it. So just by what Adam said earlier in terms of, you know, the types of followers you're attracting and what content you're putting out there, are you giving enough free content? And linking stuff up to the social media is really important, as we've been talking about.
Okay, recently. Excellent. I'm glad we're on track then.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Well, guys, thanks. Thanks for coming down.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it.
An awesome experience.
Absolutely great.
Been an honor, man.
Check this out. Go to YouTube. Check out Mind Pump TV. We drop a new video every single day. Subscribe to our channel. Also, you can check us out on Instagram at Mind Pump Media, and we have personal pages. Mine is Mind Pump Sal. Adam is Mind Pump Adam. Justin's Mind Pump Justin. And Doug is Mind Pump Doug.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.